Sanchez. Let me give you the first point of contamination that they are giving in churches about sexuality. They talk about if you are not married and if you have sex outside marriage, you'll go to hell, which is not wrong, because it is also written that homemongers and fornicators will stand outside the kingdom of heaven. But they stop there. Why are they stopping there? Because they don't want sinners to get grace, or they want to glorify themselves instead of God. Whether they are covering up, and whether they can pray for people, whether they can and prophesy, they just stop there because they want to make things as man-made instead of biblical. And and they are also talking about fasting for the right partner. That I will come to it later, but let me focus on this one. Why is there contamination? Why do we condemn people for their sexuality? Or if the Bible says that if they cannot control their flesh, their sexual desire, let them do as they please. Let them marry. That's what the Bible is saying. Bible doesn't say anything about the things that I added. It just say that if they cannot control themselves, let them marry. And if they cannot see each other as brothers and sisters, let them do as they please. Let them marry. And haven't we preached about seeking the kingdom of God? Like, seek first the kingdom of God and all shall be added. And the other points I will come to it later. Okay, now the preachers, when they preach, why are they stopping at contamination, going to hell? Because why does God, or why do we see God making sinners marry? People we consider, or people we see living in the same house, doing what they want, dating for 15 years, 20 years. Why do God allow miracle in their life? Why are they marrying? Because God loves them. And Jesus himself said that, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Now, dear preachers, dear pastors and leaders, why are you just stopping there? You must continue with the Bible, because Bible doesn't just stop at hell or going to hell. It says that if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry. It is better for them to marry than to be in passion, than to have control, than to not have control, than for control to get out of their hand. Because the flesh, no man can control it. No one can control flesh. No one can control the body. Because also the Bible knows that no matter how much you control it, it will go out of hand. That's why the Bible says that it is better for them to marry than to burn in passion, than to burn in lust. That's grace. Okay, and now the second point is that they're saying that we don't promote marriage. We don't preach to make people feel good. How are you now supposed to make people to feel bad, and to make them feel like they are sinners, to make them feel like they are miserable, to make them feel like they are nothing, or they are being judged, or they are being condemned, is end of the world for them? No way. You're supposed to give grace. You are supposed to welcome people in your house, or in God's house, actually. Whether it is your house or God's house, doesn't matter. You are supposed to welcome people with open arms. And why do you say you don't promote marriage, while the Bible does promote marriage? If you are the preacher and you say you don't promote marriage, then you don't make it biblical. You make it man-made. You make it as you're preaching outside the Bible. Because Bible talks about marriage. Since Old Testament to New Testament, Bible talks about marriage. And why do you say you don't promote marriage? And people are preaching about divorce rates, like you have the wrong partner, that's why there's a more divorce rate, or your partner was not ready that time, that's why your marriage didn't succeed, or relationship didn't succeed, or something like that. I understand about relationship, but marriage, no way. Let me give you the verse. In the Bible, there was a woman that was caught in adultery. Woman that was caught in breaking marriage. She was probably cheating on her husband with another man outside marriage. Pharisees and scribes brought her to Jesus and trying to accuse her. In the same time, they were trying to test Jesus, saying, "Master, in the law of Moses, it is written that a woman or anybody that breaks marriage should be stoned to death. What do you say? Or what sayest thou?" As in King James. Now, Jesus, knowing what they are saying, didn't pay attention to any of their words. Just keep writing on the ground. They repeat again, "What do you say, Master?" Jesus stood up, looked at their face and say, "Okay, if you don't have any sin among you, if there is no sin among you, let first man pick up a stone and start stoning her." No one did. Why? Maybe some of them were maybe having secret affairs. Some of them were maybe also having fornication. Some of them were breaking marriage. No one was perfect. No one threw the stone. So, I'm just giving you the point. If you preach about a divorce rate, don't preach like the person was not ready for marriage. Preach that will make in a sense like it's a devil that was trying to trigger the marriage, not the person, because this woman was also accused of breaking marriage because she did, but Jesus looking at her say that, "Where is your accusers?" First thing Jesus asks is, "Where is your accusers?" Jesus know that they were accusing her, not because she was sinning, but because Jesus know the attention, whether it is a right reason or a wrong reason. Jesus knew it all, and the woman says, "They are gone. I don't have any accusers." Jesus said that, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Jesus forgive. Jesus said, "Go and sin no more. I forgive you already." So, we shall say that your partner or your husband or wife who is divorced with you is already forgiven by God, because it was out of grace, or it was out of God's plan or devil invaded. Because the enemy tried to distract it, you must try to bring marriage back. Maybe the couples that are divorced already was not supposed to divorce in the first place. Maybe, yeah, your grace is supposed to bring them back. And I believe so, because the abusive husband is not abusive. The devil is trying to manipulate his mind. Or the wife that is going out every nightclub drinking. The wife that is misbehaving is not really hell. It's just the enemy messing around with their mindset, or the enemy trying to shift the atmosphere. That's how he's supposed to preach and bring grace back and make people bond in marriage. And yeah, I forget the other thing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, grace of God. Now they are saying that only the person who has the experience of marriage can preach about marriage. Only the person who has that experience. But Paul was not married. Paul was a single man, having the grace of God to preach about marriage. And he has sufficient grace to preach about how marriage is, how sexual life is wrong, and how it must be done. Paul was having things that God gave him to preach what is wrong in sexual life and what is right in sexual life. Now, it's not just people who are having experience that are allowed to preach about marriage. No way. God can give grace to anyone to preach about marriage, whether he is a married man or whether he is a single man. God give that grace to a man to preach about marriage also. No one can say that only the married couples can give counseling to marriage. God can also give that grace to the man who is not married, or the woman who is not married, to give marriage counsel. So most of the preachers, or some of the preachers, if I may say, they don't make it as biblical, they make it as man-made. They add to the word of God, which is written in the Revelation, that whoever adds something to the word of God will be judged, and whoever takes it away will be judged also. So I'm bringing you the truth. This is the straight truth, because grace can be given to someone, because same Bible say that God gives grace and the gift to anyone who he pleases to give. It doesn't mean that if I'm not married, I cannot preach about marriage. That's wrong. Okay, let's go to the next part. The other part is about the house, the car, and money. The Bible only says that if you cannot control your flesh, your body, your sexual desire, your sexual drive, it is better for you to marry. That's what the Bible says. Bible don't say you must first buy a house. Bible do not say you must get your financial issue correct. Bible do not say you must get a car or a license. What does it mean, seek the kingdom of God? It means that you must also pray on marriage and seek a way on marriage, and God will see how serious you are about your relationship and your marriage. Why does God allow people who are living in the same house to marry? Why? Because God knows their attention. God doesn't judge or look upon how they are sinning, or what sinful life they are living, or what sexual life they are living. God only looks on their mindset and what's in their heart. Where maybe the couples wanted to marry and planning together in the same house while they are trying and to control their flesh, or whether their flesh is out of hand. Inside the heart is like, please God, give us a chance to marry. Now God sees that these people are serious. Then later on you find out that people who are like, who don't believe in God but they believe in God, they don't show that they believe but they believe in God, they marry. Now we are judging like, oh, the sinners, they are married, or these two, they are married. Or who told them to marry, or why does God do unfair life? Why does he give these two to marry? Look at how much time they've wasted in their relationship. 15 years, 20 years. Look at how they have slept with one another. Look at how they have having sex, or how they have, how we are judging people instead of blessing their marriage. We are supposed to say that, oh, God is good. I can see that God has forgiven your sin. God has forgiven you as a couple because he has fought you out of this condition. He has seen your struggle and he has blessed you. So other people can also get motivation and feel welcome and loved. I'm here to correct people and I'm here to give grace as it's supposed to be. Grace is not condemnation. Grace is to welcome people, make them feel good. Grace is saving people and make them to feel welcome. Make them feel good, make them feel love. That is grace. Grace is soft, kind, loving. It does not count up wrong things that has been done. Grace does not count up how many years those two people were dating. Grace does not count up how many times they have messed up their life, or how many times they have sex before marriage, or how many times they have dwell in the same house. Grace does not count up wrong things. Grace only says you are forgiven. That's all. Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. That's grace. So with those words, peace, I'm out. And I'm just here to correct. I'm not here to judge anyone or to condemn anyone. And I'm glad you make it to the end. Please share this video. Let others hear. And let love lead. And if the truth it sets you free, don't be afraid to speak it. Stay blessed.